Hey everybody, how's it going? I'm Chase Jarvis. Welcome to another episode of Chase Jarvis Live here on CreativeLive. You're tuned in to 30 Days of Genius series. That's where I sit down with the world's top creatives, entrepreneurs, and thought leaders and extract valuable, actionable insights that you can apply to your day-to-day to help you live your dreams in career, hobby, and life. If you're new to the series, all you gotta do is go to creativelive.com/30daysofgenius, the number 30, Days of Genius. Click that blue button and then you'll get one of these awesome interviews in your inbox every day for 30 days. My guest today, you will know her from her list of accomplishments. It's too long to go through, but I'm gonna give you three high points right now. She was the founder of Flickr, which was the world's first real photo sharing site that had sort of community and creativity at its core, kicked off the Web 2.0 photo sharing world. She was the chairwoman at Etsy, took that company public in 2015, and she was one of Time's most 100 influential people on the planet. That's nuts. We're going to talk about that. My guest today is none other than Caterina Fake. Yay! Thank you so much.
It's great to be here.
Appreciate it. Thank you so much for being here. I haven't talked in like, I don't know, like 6 or 12 months. How are you?
That sounds about right. I'm doing really well,
I'm so grateful. I mean, first of all, I think of you as my friend Caterina, used to be on the board of Creative Live, and in preparation for the show, I'm like reading about you, had no idea this Time 100 most influential people in the world? What? How does that happen?
When I got that invitation to that event, it knocked me over. It was an amazing thing.
But I mean, I don't know. I had no idea. Who else was at the party? Speaking of
so
parties,
that is that was
over name droppy, but
just a name drop, just a little bit. I mean, I was at this party and I am wandering around and I am sitting at a table with Condoleezza Rice and Rachel Ray and. The guy who, I forget his name, wrote The Office, and I mean, it was like sports stars. It was just unbelievable. And the mix of people was just amazing. Amazing.
You know, instead of going down, I think a really interesting path for how you would end up there. Instead of going on the name dropper side, which I invited that, but let's talk, because that's, I think of you as a creator, as a designer, as a builder of companies.
Yes.
And the fact that you're sort of pursuing your passion and then you can end up as one of the most influential people on the planet, according to a very reliable source. How does that happen? Like, what's the path
well,
there?
It's That's not the part really, that's... yeah, it's funny because you hear that all the time. You know, do the thing that you care about, and it doesn't seem like it's actually true until then you find yourself, you know, at these things. And so it really takes a certain kind of conviction, I think, in what you are, who you are, what you care about, what you're gonna pursue, and the confidence to, through decades even of nobody caring, nobody noticing you, nobody you know, really being behind you.
Yeah.
You're not showing any of the signs of success along the way. In fact, if you looked at my high school graduating class, I would not be the one. I would not be the one that you would have picked out as being, you know, on the cover of Newsweek. Like, that just wasn't looking that way. But the thing that I had, I think, that kind of carried me through all of that was a very strong inner conviction that I knew who I was. I knew what I wanted. I didn't care about external rewards, the kinds of things that I never
chased money or fame or
even good grades in school. It was not something I was trying. So like I was one of the kids, like, you know, I knew I was smart, but I didn't care about the grades because I kind of knew that they weren't really saying very much.
Yeah,
about
a measure
me.
Of worth or a measure of aptitude.
Yeah, and
or,
so yeah. And so, you know, I was, you know, I don't even know where I was, like middle of my class.
Yeah.
I mean,
ish,
somewhere
yeah.
ish. And you know, and yet I had all these side projects. I had all these things I was very passionate about. I worked on the side. I really cared about these, I mean, it was making, undefinable. Yeah. Making things, creativity, self-expression. I was a writer, I was a painter, I was a photographer. I did all of these creative activities, not knowing where they were going to lead me.
I think that's so refreshing. You know, I have talked throughout this series and at the 5-year history of the show about sort of two groups of people, a group of people who that identify as creative, and so like, and, all right, I know I've got my start here and I need to get better. So those are the group that I call from going from 1 to 10, like getting better at your craft and figuring out who you are and what you want to do. And there's also the group from 0 to 1, and that's the group that is doing something else, something that the world has prescribed for them rather than the thing that they were supposed to be doing in life or that their next calling. And in both groups, what I find a commonality, having talked to a lot of really successful people like yourself and interacting with my community of people on CreativeLive and people who are aspiring, that you think that there is some sort of a prescription that you have to do this and this and this. And one of the things that's exciting to me is that today there is no path, or there's rather 1,000 paths to any end. So what I'd like to do now is explore a little bit. You talked about finding your way in school and maybe not being one of the best students, but can we go back and like pull on the thread of what sequence of steps that you went through and how you ended up at this time 100 most influential people. Just we'll use that thread.
How did you get
like
there?
Yeah, and the goal of the story, I guess, is to underpin that there are a million paths and that there isn't one prescription other than follow your heart. So let's talk about early creation for you. You talked about being a photographer, a painter, a designer, but let's go into career trajectory. Like, what are some of the things that you did? Were you a designer, a dancer? Like, what's their trajectory?
So when I graduated from college, I had a degree in English literature, and it was not a sequential career path. I took time off. I took my sophomore year off to write a book. I was writing a novel. Then I switched schools. I went to art school in New York at Parsons. I didn't like art school. I left art school. I ended up graduating from Vassar, but I kind of took a winding path. It wasn't a straight path at all through college. And then when I graduated, I had so many odd jobs. I was, for example, a clerk at a dive shop in Arkansas.
And then Arkansas? Is there water in Arkansas?
It is a landlocked state, indeed. But there is, but there's the White River was dammed,
sure.
And so there's big lakes there, so you can go spearfishing, and so there's diving there. I worked at a law firm. I had odd jobs. I was all odd jobs. But what I was working for was that I would work really intensely for a short period of time, and then I would strap on a backpack and head off to, say, South America or somewhere, and then backpack around for 6 months. And then I'd come back and I'd work. And my parents were being driven up the wall by this. Here I am, like 22 years old. They just paid for all of my college education. What is all that for if all you're going to do is, like, be a
backpack,
bum
and walk backpack the earth.
And wander the earth? And so that's what I was doing. And I was actually on my way to Nepal, where I was going to go rock climbing, and stopped off to visit my sister who lived in San Francisco. I'm from the East Coast.
Got it.
And so my sister lives here in San Francisco, and I was visiting her, and she was very tolerant. My trip kept on getting delayed, and then finally canceled. And she let me camp out. San Francisco was cheap enough to have a spare bedroom in those days, so I camped out in my sister's spare bedroom and just hung out in San Francisco. And so then about 6 months later, my sister's a sweetheart.
Wow.
Six months later,
she says, surfing.
Hey, you know, have you ever thought of maybe getting a job? So I said, what am I equipped to do? Not much, right? I have this kind of like very patchy resume, all those kinds of things. But the most interesting thing that was going on at the time, this was 1994. And at the end of 1993, I had been doing a temp job at Columbia University. I saw this thing, the Mosaic browser. And I knew that the most interesting thing going on in San Francisco was technology. And so I started doing CD-ROM design, which is I kind of figured I could parlay my artistic aesthetic skills into some kind of graphic design thing. and not knowing anything about it, never studied graphic design and knew nothing about it. But I kind of felt like, oh, I have good instincts in this regard. I'll figure it out. And so I started doing these sort of CD-ROMs, designing them in Director, and then got a job at one of the very first web design agencies. It was one of those interviews where nobody knew how to write HTML in those days. So I came in and they said, can you write HTML? And I was like,
yes.
Sure. Great, you're hired. And so panicking over the weekend, I was like, okay, I start this job on Monday. I need to learn how to write HTML by Monday. So I didn't even have a computer. So I get down to my sister's office down in, you know, Menlo Park, and I was like just on her computer teaching myself HTML over the weekend. By the time I showed up Monday, I kind of knew what I was doing.
You could fudge your way through it, and then there was a couple of days of training, and you stayed up all night
to figure it out. So it was like that. But, you know, I kind of had the sense that, you know, I don't know it now, but I'll know it soon.
Yeah.
And, you know, this sort of sense of being able to teach yourself. And
it's
like kind of just autodidacticism, like being able to learn on your own. And if you can learn anything on your own, which you can these days, I mean, look, here we are.
Yep.
Here we are. And I'm a huge believer in that. If you're passionate about something and you want to learn it, you can. You will.
True. It's
and
so true.
It's a thing that kind of baffles me. Because to skip ahead, I worked as a designer for a few years, and then I had, I don't know if anybody remembers this anymore, but in 2000, 2001, there was like a tech crash.
Yeah.
It was like there was a tech boom and then there was a tech bust.
The dot-com bomb.
And things had started looking pretty dire. They weren't, you know, so I said, you know, I want to go back to my roots as a creative person and start a different business, non-internet business. So I went and I I found myself an internship. Basically, I said, I want to make handbags. I decided I was not able to make clothes, but I wanted to work with materials and do creative things like that. But I knew nothing about it. I had never even worked retail. I knew nothing about this business.
So you're just following your instincts, like handbags and the next
handbags,
thing.
Right. So I'm like,
we're going to make hundreds here.
We're going to make handbags. And I called around to everyone in town, left messages, every clothing company that I could find in the phone book. And one person called me back. And I said, I will work for you for free, 3 days a week, for 2 months, if I can just attend all of your meetings and spend 1 hour a week asking questions. So totally did this, like tried to figure it out on my own. So by the end of 2 months, I kind of knew how to source fabrics, how to, you know, organize a sales pitch to Bloomingdale's, how to, you know, where the sewing comes from, how to manage a staff, retail, all these things. And
wow.
just from those 2 months, and I just asked questions, I went to all the meetings, I just like watched. And of course all the shop girls were like kicking me around and I was like steaming the clothes, and it was like not a glamorous job
at all,
by any stretch of the imagination, but I learned so much. And then I get out of there and it's so funny because like I had all these friends who were fashion designers. And they're calling me and asking me questions. And I've said, wait a second. This is all available. You just have to have the initiative and go out and figure out who knows what you need to learn and go find them
and
then offer something to them. Right?
That's the key right there. Because the people who know the stuff are very busy. And what they need is help and something that they're either not good at or don't have a time for or whatever. And being of service, I think, is a really key way to get in the door.
Exactly.
So handbags, and then go to the internet for me.
So that never panned out, because what ended up happening is while I was doing this, we kind of accidentally started this other company, which eventually became Flickr. So I never got to make my handbag company.
There's still time. You can go back and make hundreds. Let's go to early Flickr. I don't claim many things, but I was really a part of the early community. Did the first iPhone app that shared photos to social networks, and that ended up being a pretty big paradigm. But one of the things that I looked at in order to do that was Flickr. It was a big inspiration to me.
Mm-hmm.
Talk to me about, you know, conceptually the idea of photos and cataloging them and most importantly, I think building community.
Well, that's where I came from. My approach to the whole company was really from the community standpoint. When I got on the internet when I was a teenager, the whole thing was about connecting to other people. I was this lonely, kind of suburban, creative person in a town full of football players and cheerleaders. And I was just the artsy girl. And I felt like I hadn't found my people. And the internet was this amazing way of connecting to people, finding people that liked the same things that you did. And so I went on the internet with just the sense of people, community, connection. That was what it was all about. And in the early part of my career, I worked in, I worked on The Well, one of the very original online communities. I worked at Netscape's first online communities. I built a lot of these communities, Electric Minds, which was spun out of The Well. Community was my thing. That was the thing that I really cared about. And then blogging happened, and I became a really early blogger, and that community was very rich and you know, supportive and, you know, really amazing people speaking in their own voice. I mean, it was a magical thing to see all of that, to see all of that as it was happening. So the evolution into Flickr probably came out of all of that, all of that love of community and connecting people. And what better way to share your experience, easy for those of those people who are not comfortable like with prose, than sharing photographs. We felt very strongly that this was a way that people could share their lives and communicate with one another and connect to each other using photography.
So powerful. And the fact that there were, that photography really wasn't a thing. I mean, it was a thing, but that's, you know, my earlier career was about helping people understand photography because I looked at it as a black box. I wanted to figure it out. I did the same as you, banging all the doors. How did I want to enter this thing. This is really interesting.
Yeah.
And once you're in there, you're like, wow, it's not that complicated. And if I could start telling stories about it, what it was like to be here, what angle did you guys come at it from? The community part for sure. Photography is about, was it storytelling and shared experience?
Well, what was happening, like so many things were going on at that time on the internet.
Yeah.
There were a bunch of things. So for example, more than half of American households in 2003, when we started it, had broadband. So that meant that they weren't on dial-up.
Yeah.
I don't know if you remember dial-up, but that was like drinking marmalade through a straw. Like you just couldn't, like it was just no, there was no action. Like you just like wait for the, you could actually see the photograph.
Downloading like line at a time.
At a time. So it was really slow. So half of the US households on broadband, huge thing. Another thing that happened around the same time is that more than half of the cell phones were shipping with a camera. That was huge.
Big deal.
So big deal, because everybody suddenly had access to photography and digital photography. You remember the days when a digital camera was wildly expensive.
Yes.
It cost thousands of dollars. You know, we had one at the web design agency where I worked in my early days, and it was this precious object, and it was like kept locked in this like file cabinet, and you had to like sign it out. And you know, it was like this really precious and rare thing. Now they're on all the phones. So those kinds of things happen. And also, a few things also socially had changed in that Friendster, if you remember Friendster, had become incredibly popular, and people got accustomed to making profiles of themselves online. And this was a novelty.
Identity, yeah.
Online identity, having a picture of yourself online was no longer a weird thing. Writing about yourself was no longer kind of odd. It was accepted. People understood what it was. And so all of these things converged at the same time, and Flickr was just hit it just right.
So true.
Just right. You know, and the tools were getting cheaper. Digital cameras were accessible to other people, you know, that didn't have all the expense of film, you know, which was like an incredibly expensive thing to like, you know, buy the film, have it developed. You know, it was much more complex.
So fast forward a few years, Flickr grows wildly successful.
Yeah.
You sell it to Yahoo.
Yep.
And do then you just peace out? You're like, I'm done, or like what?
So while I was at Yahoo. It's so funny. When you're an entrepreneur, you work like crazy hours, and I was used to working.
That's what these dark circles under
crazy,
my eyes.
Crazy, I see. Yes.
working hard.
When you're an entrepreneur, you work hard. And after being acquired by Yahoo, I was kind of amazed. I suddenly found myself in the situation where people were like going home at 5 o'clock. So I got an email from this guy, Rob Kalin, who said, I started this new site, It's a marketplace for handmade goods, and we'd love you to have a look at it. We really love Flickr and all of those kinds of things. And would you put together a treasury, which was basically like an album of all of your favorite things on Etsy? And I was like, sure. So I looked at it, and I loved the site. And yeah. so ended up being... you know, the first member of the board of directors, helped them raise their first big round. And it was clearly a company. I mean, Rob, the founder, was one of those guys that you meet him and he says, he's this 23-year-old guy, he's like covered in cat hair and like in this like dingy apartment in Brooklyn. And he sits there on the sofa and he says, yeah, this is gonna be as big as eBay, right? And you believe him, right? There's some people when you wow. meet them,
yeah.
you okay, say man. Like, is he the guy? Yeah, he's the guy. He can do it. I I feel that you can do that. So anyway, so Etsy was him, his two classmates from NYU, brought on another couple people. I mean, it was just like five people. Like it was three, and then it was five, and then it was 20, and then, you know, next thing you know, like 8 years later, it went public and has been, it's a wonderful company. And the thing that drew me to it is that the thing that I've always liked, and the thread that connects Flickr and Etsy, Kickstarter, which I'm also an investor in, Sundance, which yeah. I'm on the board of, the thing that connects all of these different businesses or nonprofits, is that they're a platform for getting people's work out there, for them to be able to find their own vision or voice or story and tell it. And all of them, Flickr with photography and Etsy with handmade products and Kickstarter with whatever you want to make.
Expression, and yeah.
It's just all, like, there's this very strong thread that is part of that conviction that I had
yeah.
when I was sitting in my basement coloring and writing and doing photography and just making stuff. So I just wanted to make stuff.
I love that thread. I want to go back now because you've said many things that are, it's very clear to me that you were self-aware and that you knew, you had some confidence that the things that you were doing or would do were intrinsically valuable. When I talk to the creative community, that's the thing, I feel like I have that. It was instinctive for me. But I think for a lot of folks out there, it's not. So let's pretend, like, I don't want to go get too preachy, but any advice for the folks that, like, the intuition has been such a strong piece for so many people that have sat on the couch that you're
yeah,
sitting in right now?
Yeah.
Can you talk to me about that for a little bit?
Well, there's so many things that are designed to train you out of it.
Yeah.
Right? You know, teachers do not like creative children. I just put a blog post up. I have a new blog at thecreativehours.com, which
Ooh.
Is a big, which is, you should check it out.
We will.
It's like,
I'm
it's
happy.
A, it's completely
hours.
your topic, The Creative Hours. And one of the articles that I had read recently, which I wrote about on the blog, was that teachers give a lot of lip service to loving creativity. They love it. They're like, they love creativity. They really want to encourage it in their students, all that kind of stuff. But when you survey them and say, who are your best students? It's always the one who cross the T's and dot the I's. If you look at a personality profile of creative people, they're usually kind of restless. They're a little bit unsettled. They're,
yeah.
They question things. They're, even if they're not questioning it on the outside, they're questioning it on the inside.
Sure.
And the teachers reward the conformist behavior.
Yeah.
And there's so many paths in life that are, you know, my parents wanted me to be a lawyer. They wanted me to be going to, you know, whatever, banking. I mean, I was not going the path that they wanted me to go. And I was constantly being steered back onto that path. And it's very hard to resist because there's so many rewards. There's so many things. And
socially, from your parents to your friends to what you see in pop culture, all
I mean,
that
like,
stuff.
It's funny yeah. because, like, going yeah. into startups and being an entrepreneur has kind of become the investment banking of this era.
It's
right?
So ironic.
It's so weird.
Yeah.
And so, and yet, it's not the original creative impulse that drove you to do the things that you want to do. If you find yourself on that path, right? I worked as an investment banker for like 6 months. I could not stand it. I was fulfilling someone else's dreams.
Yeah.
And I left. I mean, I left. And the other thing that I decided, and it was actually very worthwhile, no matter how far you've gone down the wrong road, turn back. That is the advice somebody gave me once. If you've gone down the wrong road and you know you're on the wrong road and you're like in your last year of law school and you're like, I really don't want to be a lawyer. There's a lot of sunk costs in there, but you gotta take the true path. So we all find ourselves that.
We're like fantastic advice. There's this concept of sunk costs. I'm like, oh, I'm already so far down this path, I might as well become. And this the theme of sort of quitting or self-reflection and finding out, like, what do I really want to do in this world is such a common theme in the people, I feel like, who are living their authentic self.
Yes.
There's a writer by the name of Michael Mead. He was here at CreativeLive. I just made a little video with him. Great guy, storyteller. He worked with everybody from the Dalai Lama to at-risk gangs. And this idea of your calling and it never being too late, it's always going to be there, but the worst thing in life would be to not pay attention to that. So
yes.
You're in your investment banking job, or you're in your third year of law school, to take the point you just made. How do people reconcile? Like,
it's so hard because, like, as you know, I really think that people are the same throughout their lives. You're the same Chase Jarvis that you were when you were 16. You
so
have
true.
Like the heart that you got,
yeah.
The heart that you've got inside you is the same. Like, what did you want to be when you were a kid?
Yeah.
You gotta listen to that. Who did you want to be when you grew up, right?
Mm-hmm.
And the thing is, I think that you're the same person as you were when you were 16, but as you get older, you just take on more and more responsibility, right?
Yeah.
You have to have a job, you have to pay your rent, you have to, like, all of these obligations, you got your family, you got to take care of people.
Yeah.
And all of these things.
The shoulds, that's what we call
them. The shoulds, right? Yeah. But, like, and many of them you're not going to be able to turn. You got to take care of your spouse and your children and your family and your sick mom and, like, all of these people that are, like, depending on you. So there's so much comes down on people, and they've got a good, solid job, and it, you know, they're making it all work, and it's so hard to listen to that inner voice. And so what you got to do is, if you're in your third year of law school, or you're, like, you know, 51 years old and you're, like, got teenage kids that you're putting through school, like, whatever the thing is, you know, you got something on you. You need to make room for it. You need to just make that thing bigger and bigger inside you.
What that is a key thing that also I hear over and over is that is different than the societal picture, and that is that you find room for both things. It's what I thought you were going to say, which was I was going to question, was so you just got to stop doing all that stuff and then go do the thing.
Can't do that, because, like, you've got, like, it,
there
you
are
know,
people
life,
who, yeah.
you, there's living to do,
yes.
right? There's all of these things, and you can't just, like, bust out and be like, see
yes.
a wife and kids.
Right.
Like, I'm like, Addy, like, that's
so
not a, that's
how,
not something that you can do. So what you need to do is you need to, like, find that thing inside you and make it bigger and bigger and bigger. You start off, you take a class. You start off, you go to, like, a life drawing class, whatever your passion is. You know, you want to do photography, you want to, whatever the thing is. So you just like make that part of your life bigger and bigger and bigger and bigger, but you preserve that.
I hear also people say, I don't have time. I have three kids, I have a job, I have, you know, the kids all have homework and they all have X and Y. And is there a message that you can give to that person?
Well, I had a teacher, you know, I had a writing teacher in school. I wanted to be a writer, and I still want to be a writer. I haven't lost
clearly,
it.
Clearly, I'd love to hear that you're writing again. I'm going to go
writing
check your blog.
Which is super good. He said, look, it's a page a day. You can do a page a day. You can be, it's like a half an hour or a page a day. And if you write a page a day, he said, you are one of the most prolific, you're like Stephen King. Like, you are one of the most prolific writers around. He, like, cranks out a book, like, every year. A page a day, think about it, 365 pages?
That's a book.
So, half an hour, you gotta squeeze it in. You know, and you do it every day. Like, I just discovered that my Google inbox actually has this little thing where you can, like, do your goals. And that's when I started writing again. I put this little goal in my calendar, and it would just, like, fit it into my calendar somewhere. Half an hour?
Wow.
Somewhere. And it would just, like, fit it in. Like, oh, you have a half an hour between this meeting and that meeting. Boom, you're gonna, like, do your writing. So it's really, you just have to, just have to make it, and it doesn't have to be that big of a commitment.
And I like the idea of starting small, because it usurps this big the big roadblock for so many people. Like, oh my gosh, how am I going to become a writer when I've got clearly I've got all these responsibilities, and that, you know, 15, 20 minutes, a page, 100 words. I have, through the course of living my life, ended up in large part being a career counselor, because I, one of those, I got one of the lucky few who latches onto their passion and pull on that thread. And I can hear in someone's voice if there's a story going on of their dreams are possible or they're not possible.
Yeah.
And the story is, it's very clear, and ultimately those people for whom the story says it's not possible because I have all these other responsibilities, I've personally never sat down and talked to them face to face and changed their mind. They always have to go away and realize, and actually either want it bad enough, or the pain of the thing that they're doing relative to the thing that they were called to do is bad enough that they will ultimately find their way either back to me, or more importantly, to that true calling, where they believe they don't have to become the chairwoman of Etsy or own a design shop in New York, but they come back and they say, I'm willing to stop telling myself the story that it's not possible and start telling myself the story that I can write a page a day.
Yeah.
And it's when they do that first step, that's the 0 to 1, whether they're an accountant or whether they're doing something that they don't love, and they start writing a page a day, and that's the seed that can turn into something bigger.
There's this other blog post that I recently wrote on the Creative Hours, which was about something that I heard in a lecture from Dennis Johnson. Dennis Johnson is a writer. He won the National Book Award. He's written all these famous books. Jesus' Son, which was made into a movie, was based on his books. I mean, there's so many wonderful books that he's written. He's a very crazy, interesting, dark writer. But the thing that he said, he was being interviewed on stage by Dave Eggers, and this is in 2003, and I remember this really vividly. He got asked the inevitable question, what is your advice for young writers? And you know what he said? It was so weird. He said, move somewhere cheap. I was like, that, really? everybody in the audience is sitting there, and they've moved from way out of nowhere, Iowa.
Yeah.
To San Francisco, New York, into Los Angeles, to all of these very expensive places, in order to be around the creative community and the creative people that they wanted to be around, because they were always that kind of the artsy kid in the basement me. And so this was shocking to us, and we were like, how can that possibly be true? Because here we are. And he said, look, if you live in these expensive places, you're going to be spending all your time. You're going to be spending all your time just making your rent. So go somewhere. You're going to have to cultivate a creative community and have people that are like you and talk to you and have the same sentiments that you do, and find them and connect to them very, very deeply. But live somewhere that where your rent is low, because it's going to take decades, and you may never, publish your great American novel. So if that's the sole thing that you want to do in your life, you need to cut your expenses and move to Idaho is where he lives. so there's that too. It's
And taken either figuratively or literally, I think that in either case, it's a step towards making that thing that you've told yourself is not possible, toward making it possible.
Yeah.
Just one step. And that's the thing that I've seen it over and over. There's this cascading effect that happens when you realize that, oh my God, I can write 100 words a day or a page.
I couldn't even do that. So you know what I did?
What?
I went to index cards. So
that's starting small, right there.
I'm starting small, so this. And I was like, index card? It's so unintimidating. It's only that much paper.
It's a blank page. I can write one word and fill up the page.
Right? It's this small. I started with index cards. Really good book called The Writer's Time.
That's beautiful.
Achity. Read that. It's good.
The Writer's Time. Let's talk about some personally here. So.
Yeah.
Some personal habits. Some have come out in our conversation, like writing every day. You're back blogging again.
Mm-hmm.
Is there anything that you do every day? Do you carve out specific time? Do you have a morning routine that you really finds? We all have routines, but are there things that you feel like that you have learned to do for yourself that may translate to the folks at home?
Well, one thing that happened by accident when my daughter was born was that she liked to wake up at God knows, like 6 a.m., 7 a.m. I am not a morning person. I am a night owl. I have always been a night owl. And suddenly I had this little baby. There she was. She wanted her mommy. It was 6 a.m. I had to be there.
There you go.
So I started, I mean, it was driving me crazy because, like, you know, all the new parents out there will tell you, it is sleep deprivation for months and maybe even years. And so I went into this weird sleep schedule. I went to sleep when she went to sleep, like at 8 or 9 at night. And then I would wake up in the middle of the night. I'd be awake from 2 until 5. I would be awake in the middle of the night. Nothing was going on. No one's updating their social media. There's really, like, nobody's calling. Like, it was like this quiet, amazing time in the middle of the night. I saw all of this research that showed that this is how people used to sleep in a pre-industrial age. They used to sleep in two shifts. They used to call it two sleeps. The first sleep, the second sleep. Fascinating.
Wow.
And I found that those hours in the middle of the night, you know, this may not work for everybody, but were incredibly creative because I was uninterrupted. And, you know, you can kind of artificially create this. I read another thing on the internet that I subscribed to for a really long time, which was check your email twice a day. Schedule it for 10 a.m. and then again at 4 p.m. And that's it. And pretty soon you'll, like, train all of your colleagues and the people that want you that those are the times that you're going to be responding to email. And it's almost like cloning yourself. It's unbelievable how productive you become if you just turn off all of those distractions. Like, I'm one of those people, you know, was responsible for, like, all of the social media that's around you. Yeah. And yet I was very determined to, like, fit it into these. Like, I went through this period. It was like an internet diet where I would only go online for an hour a day. And I kept a little notebook in my pocket. You know how you're sitting there and you're talking to your friends and you're like, hey, what was the name of the Beatles' third album, right? And what happens? You're like, grab your phone, like, these irrelevant things, right? And so what I would do is I would keep a little notebook in my pocket for when I was next online. And then I would write down, what was the Beatles' third, you know, right? I would, like, write it down. And then when I got online, I would go bing, 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 bang.
When so was this? Was this diet like 20 years ago?
Or is I this, did this.
Or is this recent?
I did this. I do it periodically, and then I fall out of, you know, I fall out of practice, and so I have to kind of reel it back up again. But that was
great practice.
I mean, it was kind of an amazing thing. So, and it was like, it was literally like being twins. Like, I had, like, so much time compared to everybody else who was, like, sitting there, like, what, like, you
yeah,
know.
I see people with their email open all the time and just emails come in, ding, and then they respond.
Like, don't do chat. Don't do, like, those emails. Like, it'll make you crazy.
Bundling, like, time to me is so critical. And as a creative person, I thought for years that anything that was a schedule was the man trying to keep me down, so I'm going to live this unscheduled life.
Yeah, yeah.
And as soon as I started actually applying a little bit of schedule, not crazy rigor, but realize that if it's not on my calendar, it's not going to happen because there's a lot of inbound requirements. And one of the things that I started putting on my calendar was 90-minute blocks to do the big things in life for me.
Yep.
What's your schedule look like these days? Because I know you've got your hands in so many different things. How do you find the time?
Well, I mean, a lot of it is really regulating your energy is really the best thing to do. You know, you've got certain things you got to do. I feel like the energy to, like, answer all those emails, you know, or I feel the energy to sit down and really do some thinky stuff. Like, what's the 5-year plan?
Yeah.
Right. And so being sensitive to your own energy and what you like, what do I feel like doing right now? Like, right now I'm kind of tired. Why don't I read some articles that I've been meaning to read?
Like a lean back thing.
Just need to, like, absorb, and I'm not really thinking right now. I can't create anything right now. Like, just take advantage of that time. Like, have all of your things, like, I've been meaning to read these articles. Maybe now is a good time. I'm not feeling, like, really energetic. And then other times you're like, I'm on fire. Like, I'm going to make the plan. I'm all ready to do it. You know, like that. So, you know, regulate your energy that way, you know, and block off. That's a great thing that you do. Like, block. I do that too. Like, block off huge parts of your calendar.
Because if you don't make that time,
no
one's going to make it for you. And if you don't write your own script of what you want in life, someone else will certainly write
that for
you.
Then look at all of the things. You know, this really great video that's online by Zay Frank, which is, I don't know if you have ever seen it, but he basically takes all of the days of your life and puts them in jelly beans. He's like, this is how many days you've got. You've got this many days. And, you know, this is your first year, and this is how much time you're going to spend sleeping and eating and grooming and hygiene and da-da-da-da. And then he puts this like little bunch of jelly beans, and he's like, these are your free hours. What are you going to do with them? You know, you've got these jelly beans. So figure out what are those things. Like a friend of mine sent me this video, and she said, you know, her 16-year-old son just completely, like, watched that video and completely stopped watching video, like, playing video games. He saw that video, he's like, oh my God, I've got only these jelly beans. This is all I've got left. I'm wasting them, like, giving my jelly beans away. I'm giving it to, you know, Nintendo. Mm-hmm. And so this is like...
Mark Cuban, who's a part of, he's been on the show, part of the series, was like, follow your effort. What is it that you are motivated to spend time on? And when you realize that time is limited and you start looking at what, you know, Gary Vaynerchuk also, how is it possible that you're saying you can't start this business or you can't create a side hustle or whatever when you watch 3 hours of Netflix a day? Like, there's this an intrinsic deal when you're looking at having so much time on only having so much time on your planet. If you look back and catalog your time over the course of a week or 2 weeks, and you're really honest with yourself about how do you spend time, yeah, it's just a surprising amount of it gets chucked. I also am not a TV person. I basically watch Silicon Valley, which is 30 minutes a week, because
everybody tells me about it.
It's hilarious. It's so great. And House of Cards when that's happening, but those are really the only two shows. And I can't remember ever watching a show. And I did that very instinctively because I was like, that's so much time. So much time to burn your dreams in front of this screen.
Yeah,
it was awakening when I started in college spending my time around a lot of other people. I had roommates and watching that was a very... It was an awakening for me, like, oh God, I got it. I only got so many jelly beans. Yeah, so true. So what's on your jelly bean, like, what are you spending your jelly beans on right now?
I have another startup. I am doing Findery. I am about to launch a new company, which we can't announce yet,
Damn.
But very soon.
Okay.
It's going to be around all of the same things that I love, you know, it's kind of...
Of course, discovery, internet creativity.
Internet creativity, self-expression, people, storytelling. You know, that's kind of my sweet spot, and those are the things that I really care about. And, you know, when I left that, you know, really high-paying job, I got to tell you how I got that investment banking job. I was writing a novel, and I decided that the best way to do that was to be a receptionist. And so I was a receptionist at this investment bank, and you know, because I could sit
Hacking
there for like
system.
8 hours a day, right? Because like I don't know, I had to like let people in every now and then and call.
You're on your keyboard. No one knows what you're writing.
So I was writing a novel. I'm like sitting there behind the reception desk, and the managing director of the bank is like, hey, you're really sharp. You know, you could be an investment banker too. And of course, I'm making like $9 an hour. So I'm like, I am an artist. You know, this is not, I don't want to be an investment banker. It's never been in the cards for me. My parents would love it. But, and he said, yeah, but I'm going to pay you $125,000 a year. And I was like, my jaw like fell on the ground. I was like, what? I'm like making, I don't know. I was like, I don't know how much I was making. Like what, 15? Like what's $9 an hour? And I was making like, I was living in New York. I was like $20,000 a year or something. And so I was like, I'll take that job. So I went and got myself like some fancy shoes and I got myself a suit and I was like, going, I hated myself, right?
Yeah. Overnight investment banker. Did that turn into self-loathing?
And then self-loathing, and then like I'm walking down the street, and like all the people in like people on Wall Street, like they care about money.
Yeah,
they like care about money so much, and I was like, this is not what I care about. This is not what I care about.
So let's talk about that for a second. What's another to reference Michael Mead? He talks about you have your true calling in life, this thing that you light up when you do, and that takes different paths, but there is always something that, if you were aligned with your true authentic self, that you could be doing right now, that would just be, it would, you know, be full of self-expression and all these things.
Yeah.
And yet we have so many negative cues. We talked about it earlier. As a parent, and so many people who are listening are parents, and they're like, you know, it was a question that someone asked Michael yesterday. It's like, I'm a parent, what do I do? Because I want my kids to turn out well, and I want to be supportive at the same time, but you know, there are terms in our culture like starving artist, like deadbeat, like all these things that that are cultural constraints. You're a parent.
Yep.
Sitting right over there.
Yep.
How do you think about this, like encouraging your kids to be and do the things that they were supposed to do?
Well, you don't want them to be destitute. You don't want anybody to be destitute. And like, you may have to have a day,
love,
you may have to have your day job. Like your day job may be what keeps you afloat, but you know, you have to feed your spirit too. So, you know, you don't want to have like starving artists.
Yeah.
You know, you don't want to be somebody destitute. You don't want to be poor and miserable. And there's so much romance about that.
Yeah.
But, you know, about the struggles and the miseries of the artists. But, you know, we are a very rich country. I mean, it is really, I mean, when you look at all of the things that people need, it's not really, those things are not really needs.
Yeah.
You know, like,
cars and clothes and fancy
cars
apartments.
Cars and clothes and families. Like, if you have a hand-me-down phone that lasts you for 5 years, like, awesome.
Yeah.
You know, like
relative to the rest of the
when you start like kind of like really looking at it.
Yeah, it's really,
you know, however, true. you don't want destitution. So, you know, I think that it's important for kids to know you know, how to earn a living. I mean, it's like really important to raise kids to know how to earn a living and how to, you know, be responsible and show up for work on time and be responsible to others, and all of those things are incredibly important.
But you're clearly taking an alternative path with
your
daughter.
Yes, yes. I mean, we are homeschooling, and my daughter's been homeschooled since she was pretty much born. As you can see, I'm like a big believer in learning, teaching yourself, like autodidacticism and that, like taking it, like, you know, as far as it can go. I am a true believer in that, and really believe that your passions and your curiosity will drive you through life. And that, you know, in this day and age, there's so many things. There's CreativeLive, and online learning has just blossomed.
Yeah.
Homeschooling is growing at an extreme rate.
Yeah.
There are so many ways of connecting with other people and, you know, classes that are out there. I'm an investor in a company called OutSchool, which offers classes. I mean, there's really so many homeschooling resources and things that are out there right now that anything you want to learn, you can.
I got an online discussion. Actually, it started on Snapchat, and then I moved it out into some of my other platforms. Just that it's the first time in the history of the world where doing the traditional thing is probably actually more risky than following your passion.
Yeah.
And I see so many people signed up to do the things that other people want them to do. And what that leads to is not taking care of your body, not taking care of your mind, sort of misery, and then misery loves company. And so you end up being, if you're the average of the five people you spend the most time with, and you're in a job that you don't love around people that take energy from you instead of give you energy, like, what's the price of that? If that's the traditional path, and there are so many alternatives, ones like you just named, homeschooling, and the fact that you can ultimately, if you have access to the internet, teach yourself something, or you can go do these internships, even as a 51-year-old, you might be able to go and volunteer your time at something that makes you come alive. Like, to do anything but that seems so risky to me. Am I crazy?
Because there's very little job security these days, and you know, things change so rapidly, and industries like kind of come and go. I mean, it is a very unstable world. I mean, it's just sort of the nature of you know, our world, the current way that people work. And, you know, in a medieval era, you know, you were born a peasant, you would die a peasant, everybody would, it was like the seasons would pass, everybody did the same things that everybody had been doing for like 10 generations. And now it's just, change is basically part of, you know,
it's the only thing that's going.
Yeah, yeah, it's the only thing that's consistent is perpetual change, and you have to be able to adapt and, you know, go with the flow, and things are going to be different, and pretty soon we're not going to have cars anymore, and you know, I mean, I really think that actually cars are kind of going, you know, it will be all self-driving and
going the way of the dodo.
Going away.
So we talked a little bit about you, your background, a lot of that, some of your personal habits. I would like just maybe a little bit of a speed round. So if you could tell me something about yourself that if other people knew, they would be surprised. So what about you is a little bit of a secret that people would say, no way, I can't believe that. So it can be personal.
My daughter can probably say something to this effect.
Because so much has been written about you. You have written prolifically. But there are a few things, I'm sure, that I'll give you a couple examples. Gary Vaynerchuk, who's been on here, talked about being really adverse to conflict, yet he's so loud and boisterous. He's always on stage calling people out and everything. But he said, a one-on-one conflict, I'm really uncomfortable. Anything like that for you?
Oh, interesting. I think I'm actually one of the most reclusive extroverts that you've ever met. So I'm a very extroverted person.
Yes.
I love to get up on a stage in front of 1,000 people, give a talk. I like that. I really do. I like to give a talk, like being here.
Yeah, being on TV.
Being on TV. And yet, I'm such a homebody. I like to stay at home. I like to, you know, keep my slippers on. I like to, like, stay in my bathrobe until noon. I like to stay at home. And my...
And then,
my friend said, you know, she said, my goal in life was always to be like, a very fulfilled and happy and productive person who was able to be in her pajamas all day. I was like, that's a good thing to aspire.
Take that, yeah, ring that bell.
So, you know, that I kind of relate to that because, and I honestly think that online sociality is really suited for kind of reclusive extroverts like me. There's also these incredibly gregarious introverts too, who are like always out and like always going to events and all these kinds of things.
Yeah, I think there's a misunderstanding about the term introvert and extrovert. It's really where you get your energy from. Like, do you get energy from being external or do you get energy from being internal? So that's where you can be an internal. Or an internal extrovert or an external introvert.
Introvert and so on.
That's it. Really, I would not have pegged that.
Yeah. I'm a homebody. I like my slippers.
You've probably heard the question, like, what would you tell your 20-year-old self? I don't want to really go there. I want to know, what did you learn yesterday? Something that you learned yesterday.
Yesterday.
As proof point that we're always
doing. Oh, my goodness. You know what I started doing yesterday, which was kind of an amazing thing, was I started, when I say that I started blogging again, I literally mean day before yesterday, right?
Wow. And so, are you going to write every day? Is that the...
So I've been trying. So what I had this sudden burst of, this happens to you sometimes, you're like, oh, I can write 10 blog posts today, right? So I kind of felt like that. I was like, I'm going to write 10. So I didn't write 10, but I wrote like 4. And I queued them all up and I put them on, like, I scheduled them to be like blogging. And I had forgotten about that. I had forgotten about these bursty kinds of bits of creativity because I'd been like, you know, plodding along, doing creative stuff, but like every day, a little bit. And then you have these like wonderful explosions of super creative periods in your life. And I had forgotten about that. So I like, you know, this was kind of came out of nowhere. And I was like, wait, I can do this blogging thing, no problem. If I just do it in these bursty ways, I can do it. Because like, it's hard to like,
for
every
sure.
day,
yeah,
like, I'm not inspired today. You know, I have writer's block. I'm not thinking about it. And there's nothing interesting going on. But if you write it all at once, you know, during these like massive explosions of creativity, you can get a lot done. And if you space it out, it seems like, wow. This person is super productive. She's blogging every day.
Every day, she said. I blog once a week, and I wrote 7 posts.
Right. So that was, you know, that was kind of a revelation to me. Because when your life is like, you know, your life kind of falls into these routines.
Uh-huh.
It does. Like, you just can't help it. I think it's kind of as natural. You fall into these routines and habits and, you know, da-da-da-da. And then something jolts you out of it. It's like, hallelujah. It's amazing. Right.
Where do you speak into that? That sounds like inspiration. Where do you take inspiration? You take inspiration, is it from people or nature or technology or your internal voice? Or what are some of your core inspirations?
I'm a big reader. I've always been a big reader. So I read everything. I've got a house full of books. Like 10 books arrive on my doorstep. Like, I mean, you know, it's really funny because I was trying to plan for like how many bookshelves I need. And so I read like this many books a year, right? Like, I don't know how many that is.
It's like 36 inches worth of books.
I read, you know, like I need this much stuff. Like, I'm also one of those people who has a hard time like getting rid of them.
Yeah.
So.
Because that would mean so much to me. I love
I
that
read
book.
That. I'm gonna read that book again. So. I read so much.
That's a really.
And I have just read two incredibly inspiring and moving and beautiful books. One of which is by the 2015 Nobel laureate who I picked up, Svetlana Alexeyevich, who wrote a book called Chernobyl Prayer. Amazing. Amazing okay. stories. It's just full of these, amazing stories from what happened. Not the official story, not even the people who were, actually participating in the cleanup of Chernobyl, but everybody who was affected. I mean, amazing wow. stories, amazing stories.
Okay, that's one.
That's one. I also read a book by Carmen Laferre, who is a 23-year-old writer writing in, the 40s in Spain. She wrote a book called Nada, which is amazing, crazy, odd, interesting gothic novel about her time there. And what was the other one? Oh, Hungarian novel called The Door by Magda, I don't know how to pronounce it. It's Hungarian name, Szabo, Szabo. Really amazing book. Highly wow. recommended. So that's just in the past week. I'm
Wow. While you're on a roll here, anything else that you want to drop? Any other things that people should be reading?
Reading? Yeah. Well, my favorite. We want to go through all my favorite writers.
Yeah, a couple. Yeah, it's good.
I'm a huge lover of W.G. Sebald, who is a German writer who tragically died young. He was just being translated into English and becoming better known here mm-hmm. when he died in a bicycle accident. Wonderful writer. It's a kind of travelogues and all of that. I'm a huge fan of Vladimir Nabokov. I've read everything that he's written. I studied Shakespeare and I was a lit nerd. I was a literature geek. That's where I kind of came from. And I read prolifically. A lot of novels, I read a lot of nonfiction. I've been reading a lot of psychology lately. I've been very interested in James Hillman, who was a follower of Carl Jung. Mm. And his work is incredibly good for people seeking their vocation. It is really fascinating because our psychology...
Say his name again?
James Hillman.
Okay.
People
seeking their vocation is... Again, I'm referenced Michael Mead three times now. Vocation is your calling. It's
that's
what
literally
vocal,
what it means. Yeah, vocation.
Yes.
Yeah. Yeah.
And so are going to want to know about this. Tell me more.
And what he talks about, it's very similar to how you're describing it. Is the thing inside you. He says that all of this psychology these days makes you feel as if your childhood is what caused you, right? And he kind of flips that, you had this kind of childhood and these are the things that naturally kind of flowed out from your experiences with your parents were a certain way, or you lived in this kind of community growing up or whatever, and that kind of determined your path in life. But what he says is actually that you call it to you. You were born, and he calls it an acorn. You're born with you're this acorn, and you've got this potential that you've got inside you, and that the people in your life were called to you because of the acorn that you had. You called those people into your life. You found this set of circumstances in order to become this thing that you were meant to become. And so it's it flips it backwards, yeah. And it gives you much more agency, and it gives you much more possibility than saying my dad was really tough on me, and all that story, that narrative that you can make about your life. Instead, you kind of reframe it, and you think about it what was my father here to teach me? What is it that my acorn was asking for? He's the guy who wrote a book called, I don't remember what it's called now. It was about the soul. He talks about the soul, which nobody talks about anymore. He said the soul has gone out of psychology. It's kind of fascinating, actually. It really has. It's become very much about, data and...
Science and DNA.
Science and all those, yeah. It's a very rigid way of thinking. Whereas, truly the flourishing of the soul is what we're seeking in our lives. And so that's what his books are about. Mm. And you know,
I'm
I think
all over that.
A good intro to his work is a book called The Blue Fire, or A Blue Fire, which is a compilation of a lot of his writing.
Sweet.
Yeah, it's kind of rough going. It's like super academic. It's hard to read. It's slow going, but it's brilliant and inspiring.
I love things where they're so dense you can read a page or two and then have plenty of,
exactly.
Yeah, so plenty of time.
I read it over last summer, like the book, and it's, you know, I read like a couple pages and I'm like, wow, I'm gonna have to think about that.
I'm gonna have to take a long walk.
I'll take a few days and I'll think about that and then I'll go back to it. Really, it's like that. Oh. It's a great way of thinking.
I think people, I'm fascinated by where people take their inspiration from, and reading and the work of other people is like reference, like use guides like Hillman. Use reference like Hillman, and think of it in terms of how Austin Kleon talks about it. Steal like an artist. If you follow one person, that's stealing. If you follow everybody, that's research. Like, you know, and that's, you know, largely what these talks are supposed to be. They're supposed to be sort of little seeds of inspiration, so you can. The answer is not out there, as many people think.
Everybody has a very idiosyncratic path. I'm sure you know maybe somebody in the other 30 people that you're interviewing are interested
We're
in James Hillman
yeah.
or not. You know, it's a very idiosyncratic path, and there's things that, you know, if Ramones lyrics are where you get your inspiration, then Ramones lyrics will be what it is. So it's not, you know, there's no formula, and you tend to be like, I like that thing. Give me more of that.
And people, why is it so hard to listen to that voice? Because everyone has that voice. And we've spent, you know, we've talked about it a couple times already in this talk. There are so many things, whether they're parents who are thinking about what they wanted to be and mapping that onto you and telling you to be an investment banker, or where there are teachers who say that they give lip service to creativity and they really want you to just be the next science teacher, or like there's so many competing voices. How do you pay attention to that inner voice?
Because it's all about, you know, success. That is what it is. It's the drive to success that is killing people and is killing people's souls. And the way to be successful, people know that if you follow this path and you do these things and you follow this formula and you go to Stanford and, you know, there's these very clear paths to success. And, you know, I remember like reading the comment of a psychologist who worked in Palo Alto, where like it's just the city full of the most successful people in the world in technology. It's amazing. He said, so little success, so little happiness. And it's that drive to be successful. And
that actually leads you astray.
That actually leads you astray. You want to be successful. You want to be a successful entrepreneur. You want to be a successful artist. You want to be a success, and that is the thing that leads you astray. It's crazy.
By flipping that, what is the thing then that does lead to success? What is the polar opposite of chasing success?
Because you can't, stop chasing prizes that you don't want, you know? Like, those prizes are out there. There's prizes everywhere you look. There's prizes. You can see the prize. You can know how to get to the prize. And
what should you be chasing instead?
You have to be chasing this this sense of what truly makes you happy, and you know what it is, and it's usually not money and success. And there's so much of our culture is wrapped around how to be successful. I mean, it's really astonishing, and you know, it's a hard thing. I mean, it was really funny. I was doing an interview with Nick Bilton, who is a reporter for New York Times.
Yeah.
And I'm like going in, they had a brand new skyscraper in Times Square, beautiful building. And I'm sitting there being interviewed by Nick Bilton of the New York Times. And I'm saying like, you know, I had this like just weird vertigo. I said, I don't even really understand why I'm sitting here talking to you. Like how it is that I got here. And I think that the thing that was very clear to me when I was sitting, I remember very vividly this moment. I remember sitting and thinking that if I was just sitting alone in my room doing what I was doing without any of that, the external, like kind of accolades coming at me, I would still be happy. I would still be happy. What is that thing? And all of this stuff is accidental, and it's honestly not, you know, I you know, whatever, Flickr was a huge success, and I like flew to Davos, and I like sat around with like heads of state and like did all these kind of fancy things, and I was like flying around on the Google Jet and like all of this stuff, right? And which is cool, and you can do it for like a certain amount of time, but I remember having this conversation with my friend, and I was supposed to go have dinner with Rupert Murdoch and his wife, and some other famous people, and I didn't want to go. And my friend said, no, but Rupert Murdoch can help you with your business. I was like, no, he can't. I really need like a really good graphic designer. He doesn't know a single one of them. I'd rather be hanging out in basements with like 20-year-old graphic designers in Brooklyn than going to this like skyscraper. I don't like, it's like really those things don't matter. And like, you know, I've been fortunate enough. I mean, I've been very lucky. Like very few people get the chance to like turn down invitations from Rupert. Yes. But like, it's so true.
Having like, done those things.
Having done it. Yeah. Like you come out the other end and you're like, well, that was very fancy.
I think it was Neil Strauss you know? Told me a story about Lionel Richie, and Lionel Richie in like his peak of the 80s, just winning everything, climbing the mountain is the story that he talks about. And then when he got to the top of the mountain, there was no one there.
Exactly.
And that it really isn't that destination. It's that journey. Who are you spending your time with? What are the moments where you're doing the things that you're supposed to be doing? That pursuing your passion is passion, obviously, music. And it was that path that was the reward, the success, the thing that you can stick a flag in on top of a mountain is lonely and not the thing.
Yeah. I mean, being surrounded by people that you love and, you know, caring for them and loving and being loved, those are like the most important things, and everybody knows that.
From being in your basement to all those different school paths, in and out of school, art school, no art school, investment banking, Vassar, starting a little internet site, becoming wealthy, chairwoman of Etsy, and full circle here to the time 100 most influential people on the planet.
Yeah.
All by just doing the things that felt good to you when you wake up in the morning.
Yeah. Yeah.
I don't know a better way to end an interview. We went a little bit longer than I had told you we would, but I want to say thank you so much for taking your time. Any advice or anything you want to leave us with? No pressure.
Never. Well, I mean, I think it's something that you have to do every day and just start where you are with what you've got and the time you have.
Thank you. All right, everybody. Another one of these interviews in your inbox tomorrow. Thanks for tuning in.